It's my first time playing the forwards, because I was originally in the centre, believe it or not. So in the first 15 minutes, there was a maul, and whatever way my leg went, it dislocated again. So I thought that was it, really. I thought my dream of playing senior cup was over. So obviously I was extremely disappointed. But I worked hard, you know, and once the physio told me that I had a chance to play in senior cup, I worked extremely hard, and it paid off in the end because I got back a few weeks before the cup, and I was picked to start, so I was obviously thrilled. I was obviously a brilliant feeling, you know, to be part of the senior cup winning side, to be part of a brilliant team as well. It was even more kind of special because I was playing alongside the likes of Joe Slack, Keith Earls, Ian Broderick. I mean, just so many quality players, like, you know, who played inter-provincial rugby as well. But I was absolutely thrilled. I'd never played in a game with such intensity in my life. So I mean, I taught Rockwell. I didn't think it'd get any harder. And then we played Crescent Camp, which was just. I mean, I thought we were lucky to win it in the end. But we played PBC in the final then, obviously, on St Patrick's Day. I'll never forget it. Like, it was the highlight of my year, the highlight of my rugby career so far. But it was just delighted I was part of the winning cup side of Munchins. My favourite player in rugby would have to be Dennis Leamy. I admire him so much because I just love the way he plays the game. He's a brilliant tackler, and he's just a great ball carrier. And I just admire him, all the other dedication to the game. So he'd have to be my favourite player. Since I came into Munchins, I'd have to say it would be Miss Lowe, Miss O'Donoghue, and above all, it's in Miss Faye. My ambition for the next few years would obviously to do well in this year's Eden Cert. I'm a repeat student at the moment, and I didn't do too well in last year's Eden Cert. Obviously, the main reason I repeat it the most and is to win another senior cup, and hopefully I think we'll bring a chance to do it because we've a very talented squad, and with the players to do it, so I think we might do it this year again. When I get out of school, I hope to go to college in either UL or LIT, and I just hope to carry on, keep playing well in rugby. So.
Why did you decide to become a rugby coach at St Munchins College?
Well, what actually happened was Mr Madden and Mr Dunhu came to me and asked me would I get involved, and I thought it would be a really good idea. I mean, there's great rugby tradition in the school, and I felt like it would be great for me to get involved in it. I've always wanted to get involved.
Did you get support from other teachers, seeing that you were the only coach from the female staff?
I actually got great support from the teachers. They first of all, it was a big joke, and it was everybody kind of was joking with me the whole time about it, but Mr. Broderick and Mr. Cross and Mr. Madden and Mr. O'Donoghue were all very, very good to me, and any questions that I had, they had no problems answering, and they were very, very supportive, I have to say. And the female staff were as well. They thought it was great fun that I was actually going out to do it.
What did you hope to achieve by becoming the first female rugby coach?
I really didn't think of myself becoming the first female rugby coach in the school. I just thought of myself really as anybody else in the staff, and I just felt like I just wanted to get involved and kind of get into the whole thing as well. It's a great way of getting to know the lads, and just giving up your time after school, I think they really appreciate it.
Would you encourage more female teachers to get involved in the rugby in the college?
Oh, definitely, and I think more female teachers will be getting involved in it. I think Miss O'Donoghue is actually interested in getting involved in it next year, so that should be great.
Yeah. And have you any plans to coach again when you return to the college next year?
Well, at the moment what I'm actually doing is there's no facilities for me. There was no female toilets, nothing like that. I had to go into the male toilets with some of the lads standing outside to stop all the people from coming in when I got changed. So that was a bit of a drawback. They're not really used to female coaches, and I think that's something that they should take into consideration.
Which teacher tickets you fancy?
There's so many to choose from. I don't think I could pick one. But I really don't think I could pick one. I really couldn't pick one. I mean,
pick two.
It would have to be the senior rugby coaches then, without a doubt.
Okay.
Of last year, of course.
Do you feel that St. Munchins academically help you to get where you are today?
I think that there's no doubt about it. I always thought about Munchins. There was always a good mix of, a good mix of academic and sport in the whole school. I remember, our leaving cert class that year. Everyone that you'd know from it, whether it be the rugby guys or the other guys, have gone on to do, pretty well in life. So I think it certainly helped me in a lot of ways. I'd always had a big interest in English, so that was obviously my specialist subject as such. So, I mean, we had a great English teacher through the years, which helped me out a lot. So, I do think it certainly helped me a lot to where I am today.
Who was your favourite teacher when you were in St. Munchins?
Well, I suppose the thing was that I didn't like maths, science, anything got to do with numbers, accountancy or anything like that. I remember I had Dermot Madden or Mr. Madden for English. So I suppose, that was the subject I was most interested in, and he was always very helpful. He'd always be, if you wanted to hand up an extra essay or something, he'd have no problem correcting if you had helping you out and making a few pointers. So I think basically because I liked English, I think it was him.
What is your greatest memory of your time in Munchins College?
I think it's probably like a lot of people's memories of Munchins. It's a lot of sporty memories. I can remember being a supporter at the Munster Senior Cup final. I think it must have been back about 97. And I remember Munchins were about 13-0 down at half time. They were playing PPC. They were 13 or 14-0 down at half time. And Jeremy Staunton scored two fantastic tries within the first 5 minutes of the second half. And, from a position where everyone thought Munchins was going to get trashed about 28-0. They came back to being, I think it was 14-13 in front, and just that 5-10 minutes was absolutely fantastic. They went down to lose the match that day, but for sheer memories, and that 5 minutes, that was the one that kind of still sticks in the memory.
Did the popularity of sport in St. Munchins influence you in your career?
Ah, definitely. I played a little bit of rugby in school, not to any great level, but it was one of the things that was always there. It was always around you. You'd come into school on the Monday morning, and you'd be talking to all the lads who'd played at the weekend, and you'd be wondering how other lads got on, and then you'd be meeting up with your mates, your schoolmates, to go on and go out at the weekend and go up to Gary Owen or Shannon or whatever and watch a few matches. So it's what everyone talked about at break time. So I don't think if you're in a school like Munchins, you can escape sport at all. It's just part of the culture, the place.
Did you play any sport when you were in St. Munchins?
I played rugby in the school. As I said, not to any great level. It was one of the strange things where I was actually overage for the year I was in, so it was always a little bit difficult to get on the year above you. But I suppose one of the funny things about being a sports journalist is that people that are sports journalists are good at writing and not good at sport, which is stands out a little bit. But played a little bit of rugby and that was it. I didn't go near the GAA or the hurling or the football.
From what you've seen, do you think that the standard of senior and junior rugby in St. Munchins is very high?
I definitely think so. I mean, I spent a good bit of time up in Dublin now, and you'd head along to watch the Blackrock Colleges and the Clongowes Wood and all that, and you see such media coverage of these teams, and you think they're the best teams in the world. The way the media build them up there, but you come down and you watch the Munchins boys, and it's just as good. And I suppose in a lot of ways, it's better. It's Munster rugby. I think the boys are a little bit more tuned in to what they want to do. There's, you know, they're very focused. And I think up in Dublin a little bit, boys can get carried away with the other side of being a school rugby player, like the social side of it. But I think if you're talking about Munchins and a lot of schools around Limerick and Cork, they're very focused on their rugby, and they you know, they really want to do well in it, and it's a, you know, they're very, very dedicated. I suppose that's the thing, that they're a lot more dedicated than the guys in Dublin.
Who do you think is the greatest rugby player in the world, and why?
I suppose from the guys I've watched over the past couple of years, and one guy really stands out would be Dan Carter. He was over in New Zealand for the Lions tour back in 2005, and I can remember that second test in Wellington where I think he scored something like 28 points. He scored 2 tries and 5 penalties or something. But he was absolutely unbelievable that day. And, you know, he's only 21 years old, only coming into the All Black side. And he basically beat the Lions on his own that day. And just, you know, everyone came off the pitch that day. Everyone came away from the pitch that day saying, oh my God, I don't think we're ever going to see a more complete performance than that. And I suppose he's kicked on from there even. You know, he's got better from that day, which I suppose there's not a guy to match him really.
From your knowledge of the game, what do you believe are the most important attributes that a rugby player needs to excel in the sport?
I suppose it's kind of back to what I was saying a minute ago about the Limerick guys and the dedication. Any of the guys I've seen over the past few years and I've watched playing and watched training, and you talk to them and you interview them, the guys that succeed are the guys that put the effort in. You know, they build their lives around rugby. We were talking about guys like Paul O'Connell and, you know, Dennis Leamy. You talk to these fellas and they're so dedicated to their profession. You know, everything they do in their life, like whether it be socially or whatever, is built around rugby. What they eat, what time they get up in the morning, what time they sleep during the day, you know, to have their afternoon nap. It's all about rugby. So I think it's dedication. You obviously have to have a bit of skill, but you see plenty of guys who have skill but not dedication. They fall away. But the guys who have the dedication and put in the hours and put in the hard work, they're the guys who succeed in the end.
When I came to the school, I didn't realise there was such a huge tradition of hurling and GAA in the school. Definitely, there was a huge tradition in terms of Keith Wood, Anthony Foley, Marcus Horn in terms of rugby, but there's two sides to the school, I feel. There's the GAA guys and the rugby guys. Now, we all get on well together and so on, but if you go out to the field any Monday and Thursday, you can see up to 100, 120 kids playing hurling. So therefore, for those guys, hurling GAA is a first priority, and they're being well cared for in the school. So you ask up and ask any of those guys first year right through to leaving cert, what's their first priority? GA is their love, and I think they're being well catered for. There's no such thing from the management of the school saying rugby is first priority, or Mr. Freely who's head of sport, or any of those guys. They all get on well, and sport is possibly a big priority in the school. I wouldn't just say rugby is a priority.
Do you feel that GA in the college has regressed since your arrival here?
I've been in school 6 years, and I feel I've only continued the work done by the likes of Austin, Father Austin McNamara, Father Eamon Fitzgibbon. Austin was very, very successful in his year. He was a great guy, and I'm only basically continuing his work. But in the last 6 years, we've 4 competitions, 1, 2 county and 2 Munster championships. And some of the biggest joys I've got is the number of guys from the school who've gone on to play inter-county hurling. For example, last year in the Clare Minors, we had 5, the second biggest school outside of St. Flannery's College being represented. So that to me gives me great joy, and got a great buzz seeing guys going on playing with Limerick and Clare for their county.
How do you feel when you see talented hurlers quit so that they can take up rugby in school?
To be honest with you, I don't know where this question is coming from, because there aren't too many guys who have said, sorry, I'm giving up hurling to play rugby. A couple of months ago, Keith Wood came here with the RBS Six Nations, and he said one of the big areas that helped him develop in the rugby career was the time he spent playing GA. And same with Anthony Foley, same with Marcus Horn. Marcus Horn played up to minor with Clonlara. Anthony Foley played under 16 with Clare. Keith Wood played minor with Clare. So I don't see where this question is coming from, saying guys dropped out to play GAA. Everyone gets on well here. John Broderick would be a very good friend of mine. He's head of rugby here, if you like. And basically, he has no problem with any guy playing rugby and GAA.
What was the school's biggest achievement in hurling under your management?
Well, we won the Munster under 16 and a half against Gaelscoil Monaster Huy from Cork, who was trained by Donal O'Grady. It had been the third final that those guys had been in, and we had lost the previous two. So there was a great sense of fulfilment and achievement, obviously, winning that. And also, the manner and the way we won it, we played fantastic hurling. It's not all about winning, it's kind of the way you play. And I think most guys got a game throughout the competition, and basically, who likes being a sub? I think every competing, every putting on a school jersey, getting a sense of pride and representing your college, that's what it's all about. It's not all about medals, but obviously we're after being a school with a huge hurling tradition, a super manager, and particularly having lost the two previous, it was a huge sense of fulfilment for everybody.
Feel that young hurlers with serious potential can progress into Munchins College?
Well, as I've already stated, last year Clare Minors, we had five on it. The previous year we had two. The year before that we had two also. So I think that is the highest level for those guys. At this moment in time, we've those five guys who represented our county last year are now going on playing University Hurling. Hopefully we'll play Fitzgibbon and so on. Hopefully in the next number of years, there's kids in this school, both past pupils over the last number of years, and kids at present in school who are good enough to go on and play into county senior. And I look forward to the day going into Gaelic Grounds or Semple Stadium to see these guys playing for their county. All of them.
Stop the sec. Any of the teachers in the school take your fancy?
What has that got to do with sport and GA in the school? But I think Superman is quite cute, alright?
Advice for young hurlers going through?
Enjoy the game. It's the greatest game in the world, in my opinion. It's not all about winning. Go out and practice skills and enjoy it. And get a buzz putting on your school jersey and getting off free class.
But rugby and GAA are equally supported by the students and staff in the school.
It's hard to say what you mean by equally supported. Both are well supported. Obviously, rugby is the number one sport in the school, and GAA comes in after that. Now, any school that wants to play a sport at a very, very high competitive level, which we do at rugby, well then, other sports then have to come second best. Our GAA as well have teams at all age groups, and have all coaches for all age groups, and we do very well. And we are one of the few schools in the country that carry the sports, carry both sports at both a reasonably high level. Now, in recent times, we've been very successful in rugby due to all the hard work of the coaches and the dedication of the players as well. And the GAA hurling has had some victories in recent time, notable ones. And as well with the football, we've had a lot of guys have played with Limerick colleges, and their boats have done quite well.
In your opinion, is the greatest ever sporting legend in this school?
That's a very difficult question, because Munchins College has a great sporting reputation dating back a long time. The first name that comes to mind obviously would be Keith Wood, who became a World Player of the Year and played with the Lions. Colin Tucker also played with the Lions. Then if we think back, Philip Danaher captained Ireland. John Peck obviously played for Ireland as well. That would be in the 80s. In more recent times, Anthony Foley has become a legend for both Ireland and Munster, and captained them to the Heineken Cup last year. And as well, Marcus Horan, Jerry Flannery, John Stone, Paul Hogan have played for Ireland.
Thank you.